I recently made a poll asking you if you would like to watch Generation 3 versus Generation 4 reactors or the different types of Generation 4 reactors. So I thought that it would be a great idea, since the poll ended up pretty much at 50-50, to start from the beginning, to start by introducing Generation 1, 2 and 3, and then later on discussing what are the advantages of Generation 4 and why are we moving towards Generation 4 reactors in the nuclear industry. So without further ado, let's get into it. So starting from the Generation 1 reactors, these were the first ever reactors to be constructed. They were pretty much constructed around the 50s and the 60s, when the nuclear power became a thing, when people discovered fission and started working on it and understanding that they could make such equipment, such as reactors, to make energy out of nuclear fission. Therefore, these reactors were mostly experimental, quite small in size compared to the one that we have today. So those kind of reactors were the Fermi 1 reactor, for example, and two other reactors, the shipping port in the US is another example, and the Calder Hall in the UK. These two you can see up here. As I said, these were the early prototypes connected to the grid to produce electricity. The last ever Generation 1 reactor was shut down in 2015 in the UK. So having learned from this and acquired experience from Generation 1 reactors, we move on to Generation 2, and these were commercial reactors, pretty much the designs that we are currently employing in the nuclear industry and make energy and electricity from. These reactors are of large scale, connected to the grid, producing electricity, and are typically four types. They are pressurized water reactors, boiling water reactors, CANDU reactors, which is the Canadian design that uses the heavy water and natural uranium, and the VVERs, which is the Russian design, which is basically a pressurized water reactor as well. So those four designs were the early on designs that were constructed and were supposed to be used for approximately 40 years before they shut down to produce electricity to be connected to the grid. An example of these types of reactors is the Diablo Canyon in the USA. Those reactors, even though they were larger and they were already operated on some experience that was learned from the Generation 1, they didn't really have any advanced safety features. They were mostly relying on active safety, which means that the operator himself or herself would need to activate some sort of button or some sort of sequence for the safety features to be turned on inside these reactors. So as you can understand, this is not ideal. And hence, from Generation 2, which was pretty much from the 70s to the 90s, we move on to the Generation 3 reactors. And these are basically evolutionary designs on the Generation 2. So they are not different reactor types, they are still the same pressurized and boiling water reactors. However, with advanced safety features, mostly focusing on passive safety, meaning that the reactors themselves could self-regulate and not needing so much active attention from the operator in order for them to shut down, for example, in case of an accident or in case of something is going wrong outside in the environment of the power plant or in the reactor itself. These types of reactors started to be built in the 90s and early 2000s. And some of these examples is the AP600 made by Westinghouse and the EBWR, the European Pressurized Water Reactor. Now, moving on from the Generation 3 reactors, we have an intermediate generation, which is called Generation 3 Plus, which was basically introduced in 2010 and 2020. This is the most advanced generation when it comes to the still water-cooled reactors, such as PWRs and BWRs. This emerged with a need for extra safety systems, especially passive ones, when it comes to, for example, since the Fukushima accident happened in 2011. So then after that, the scientists started thinking of extra passive safety systems that would be needed to be introduced in the Generation 3 reactors to enhance their safety and enhance their reliability, enhance the low risk and the low probability of a core melt or any other severe nuclear accident that would result in environmental contamination and contamination to the people. Therefore, these extra safety systems were then implemented to the existing Generation 3 and Generation 2 reactors, and with that in mind, we have the intermediate, as I said, step, which is a Generation 3 Plus, which one of the examples is the AP1000 from the Westinghouse. Another one is shown here, is under construction in India. And this concludes the basically 50 to 70 years of development of nuclear energy when it comes to mostly light water reactors. So when we use light water reactors, we already explained in previous video that these were not the most ideal or the most efficient ways to utilize nuclear energy. However, it was the simplest way to go about it, since using water as a coolant is pretty much readily available. There is no extra technology or R&D necessary to develop such reactor design. Using enriched uranium fuel is something that we already know how to do, and the technology is in place. Therefore, the light water reactors were the way to go from there on. However, stepping away from the light water reactor technologies and introducing a whole new type of technology systems, such as the ones existing in Generation 4, that happened for a reason. So let us discuss first, what is the goal of Generation 4? Why would we aim to build Generation 4 reactors compared to the ones we are currently using? So Generation 4 is basically a concept that was introduced in the 2000s, and that is basically built on four goals, four pillars, and this is sustainability, economics, safety, and proliferation resistance. If we go about breaking down each one of them, we can discuss a little bit further what is the goal for each pillar separately for the Generation 4 to basically achieve. When it comes to sustainability, this would be improved fuel utilization, which means making designs that could utilize more of the fuel that we introduce inside the reactor compared to the light water reactors that use, for example, thermal neutrons, therefore utilizing only the uranium-235, which we know to be the least percentage of uranium present compared to the biggest amount of uranium-238, meaning that, for example, if we introduce fast neutron reactors, therefore we could utilize the biggest amount of uranium-238, hence having a much bigger resource availability for those types of reactors to be used in the future and produce electricity for much longer time than the reactors we are currently using. Another aspect that goes under sustainability is recycling of fuel, meaning that since we can actually use the uranium-238, means that the fuel that is currently sitting as waste from the Generation 3 reactors and Generation 2 can be recycled, changed in a way that fits the new reactor designs, and be burned or be fissioned inside the new Generation 4 reactors, therefore be used for hundreds and hundreds of years compared to mining new uranium and depleting this source much, much quicker than something that would have happened if we continued with Generation 3 reactors. Another very important aspect of sustainability is the fact that we can reduce the need for a long-term storage of the spent nuclear fuel, since the Generation 4 reactors will be able to burn, or in another way, more scientific, transmute such elements called minor actinides, which are americium, curium, neptunium, etc., which are very long-lived and actually contribute to these hundreds of thousands of years that we're discussing, that we need the geological repository to last for the fuel to drop its radioactivity levels to natural uranium levels. Therefore, in that case, we would still need some hundreds of years or a few thousands of years, but definitely not hundreds of thousands of years for the fuel to be maintained underground, which is a very big plus for the safety and the resource utilization and sustainability of the nuclear industry as well. So when it comes to the economics, these reactors aim to be as economically as any other renewable and sustainable energy source out there, meaning that they would want to compare financially with the available sources that we have. This could be utilized with the fact that these reactors would not really require a new fuel mining, but as we said, more so the reprocessing of the fuel that we currently have, so the waste that's currently sitting could be used to fuel these reactors. Another plus when it comes to the economic aspect that the nuclear industry doesn't currently have is that these reactors are planned to be smaller and more mass-produced and easier to be produced and installed in each areas, making them faster to produce, hence by streamlining this process, reducing the cost of every reactor that's produced with this kind of design, and instead of basically producing a one-of-a-kind prototype reactor every time that the industry decides to make a reactor in another country, which is pretty much what we're doing right now. Every time we want to build a Generation 3 reactor, it is somewhat, somehow a little bit different from every other one that we have built. Therefore, the whole licensing process, everything basically has to start from the start. It's like we are reinventing the wheel every time we're building a reactor. And this, of course, contributes significantly to the time delays, to the cost associated with building new reactors. Therefore, by somehow streamlining this process and making it more factory made, let's say, it will be much more economical in the future to build this type of reactors compared to the Generation 3 reactors that we are currently building. Of course, this doesn't go, it goes without saying that we will need significant amount of R&D and funding to develop these reactors, to develop all of these materials that will be used in these reactors, to make them competitive economically to the reactors that we are currently using and the other energy sources. And of course, at the moment, since the technology is experimental and it's under research, significant funding needs to be significant. And since the technology is still under research and development, there needs to be significant funding for it to reach the stage of commercial and economical attractiveness. When it comes to safety, this is an aspect that the Generation 4 heavily works on. And in safety, there are several aspects such as passive safety systems, natural physical laws that the reactors operate under that would make them virtually impossible to have any sort of core melt or any sort of explosion or any sort of severe accident that would result in environmental and human contamination. For example, core melts are even more reduced in these reactor designs, which introduce passive safety features such as negative coolant coefficient, which basically means that if the temperature in the coolant inside the reactor will rise, then the temperature of the fuel will drop, basically making it able to shut down by itself naturally without the intervention of any operator or any such active safety system. Another, for example, idea is such thing called core catcher, and that means that in case of high temperatures inside the core that could result in a core melt, the core can be basically dropped inside the big cooling pool that will basically stop the fission, of course, and reduce the temperature of the whole fuel inside the core. Another safety feature is the fact that these reactors are designed to have in mind the elimination of the off-site emergency response. So basically, they are designed to not need any off-site, any outside of the power plant response or help for them to cool down or shut down or not cause any severe nuclear accident, which is of course very important to have a system that is self-sustained and you are sure that it can shut down under some sort of accident conditions. And the last but not least goal that the Generation 4 reactors aim to tackle is the proliferation resistance. And with that in mind, the fuel is basically made in a way that would make it the least attractive route for proliferation purposes or for terrorist thefts to be used for proliferation purposes, therefore making it even safer in that sense. And every design of the Generation 4 is made with that in mind. And of course, some designs, this is easier to be introduced than in others. In some designs, reprocessing is required. So there, the question of proliferation comes very strongly in place. In some designs, this is not necessary, as for example, fuel will stay throughout its whole lifetime inside the core, and then the whole, let's say, core will be replaced, therefore making it much harder for proliferation and for reprocessing in order to extract, for example, plutonium from it, which is a very important advantage and even important safety feature when it comes to the proliferation. Several countries pursue Generation 4 concept reactors and develop them at different stages. Such countries is the United States, China, Russia, France, and Sweden that are actively working on their own Generation 4 reactor types for their own purposes and their own reasons, since every one of the six Generation 4 reactor types aims to tackle a different aspect or focuses more on one aspect than the other. Hence, every country would like to focus on what is for interest of that particular country. Therefore, to sum up, the advantages that the Generation 4 reactor types offer over the Generation 3 and the types we are currently using is first that they can reduce the amount of the spent nuclear fuel that we are currently having in storage, first in terms of volume and utilizing that to produce electricity, and secondly in terms of long-lived radiotoxicity of the fuel itself. Secondly, they can produce more energy than the reactors that we're currently having, since they are employing fast neutron spectrum, means that they can utilize fuels such as natural uranium, which is the biggest amount of uranium that we currently have. Also, fuels such as plutonium mixed with uranium, thorium mixed with uranium, and all these kinds of innovative fuel cycles that are not possible to be utilized by Gen 3 reactors. They can improve the operating safety, since they are going to be built in mind to have practically no release to the environment around them in case of an accident, and a very low need for off-site emergency response in case an accident will occur, and as we said, strong safety, passive safety features that will be enabled automatically by themselves, governed by laws of physics, without the need of an operator to intervene. They are also being made with proliferation resistance in mind, meaning that the materials that are going to be used are going to be made in the least attractive way for proliferation, meaning that they will be hard to reprocess, therefore separate and use for any kind of theft or the creation of some sort of nuclear weapons. Additionally, Generation 4 reactors will be able to produce high quality process heat, which therefore will give the possibility to produce, for example, hydrogen, which will help very much with reducing the greenhouse emissions and also our dependence on fossil fuels. However, now that we have summed up all of the advantages, it is important to state that all of these reactor types are still experimental and none of them has been proven to work or yet employed. Therefore, it is important to know that they will be worked upon and improved even more. However, some of them lack operational experiences compared to others that we already have some experience from. And this is an important feature, that as much as you would try to improve the safety, only by building and operating a reactor, one would actually get valuable information about how to improve it even more. And goes without saying that since these reactors are quite new and the technology is still very much in the development and research stage, they cost quite significantly in the stage that they are right now, with the hopes that with mass producing them, the cost will be driven down. And that sums up a short introduction on the Generation 1, 2, 3 and 3 Plus reactors that we are currently using in the nuclear industry for electricity production, and an introduction to the Generation 4 reactor designs. So let me know down in the comments below what you thought about this video, and if you want me to make a future video explaining every Generation 4 reactor type separately, what are the advantages and disadvantages of each, as well as which countries are focusing on which reactor designs. Don't forget to like and subscribe and turn on the bell notification icon. It's been Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and until next time, see you soon!